Allow me to share my screen. So my task today is to report on exact solutions to certain differential equations that are inspired by the oscillator of classical physics. So there are methods in solving differential equations, and some of them are well known to physicists and mathematicians. One of the most popular procedure is the so-called Frobenius method, which is a way of substituting a series for the unknown solution to the differential equation. But today, we will report certain miraculous solutions. Exact solutions can be obtained from some clandestine point transformations that will render the problem connected to the oscillator differential equation. So this is the abstract, and let's start this enterprise. Differential equations appear naturally in physics because the laws of motion are most often written in terms of second order differential equations. Newton's second law is all about acceleration being caused by certain forces, and the forces may depend on position, velocity, or even time. When the force is only dependent on position, it is called a conservative force, like gravity and electrostatic forces, the elastic force of a spring. Those are conservative forces. They conserve the mechanical energy. But when there is a velocity dependent, like drag, friction, and things that change in time, forces that change in time, then the mechanical energy is no longer conserved and the system is no longer conservative. Sometimes it is referred to as dissipative or driven system. So that's where we find differential equations. It's directly a consequence of the laws of motion. Second law of motion from Newton and other laws in the other realms of physics. For the case of an object attached to a spring, sliding horizontally without friction, then there is this Hooke's force or elastic force that is against the displacement, but proportional to the displacement. So it has a minus sign, minus the force constant times the displacement from the equilibrium. That is Hooke's force. That can also be written in a standard differential equation like this, with a definition of omega square root of k over m. So that will be our most basic and most used differential equation in physics. There are many applications to this, not just in classical physics, but also in other realms like quantum mechanics, electrodynamics, and many other fields. So there's no friction in this, so this is a conservative system. The solution to that differential equation can be written in alternative ways. These are the four popular ways of presenting it in textbooks. The first one, equation four, is a combination of cosine and sine. As you can check, you can differentiate a cosine or a sine two times, and it will basically return with a negative sign. So it will easily satisfy. You can see that it satisfies this differential equation by direct substitution. Another way is in terms of just a cosine with a modified phase in the angle. It's a phase constant. For those authors who use sine, there is also this form. These are all equivalent. And finally, there is a complex version, which is it has this exponential of I omega t and e to the minus I omega t. All of them have two arbitrary constants. In the first case, you have A1, A2. In the second case, you have A and pi, A and delta in the third case, and C1 and C2 in the fourth case. But these are all equivalent. The quickest way to see the equivalence, for instance, let's try to link 5 and 7. Okay, this A cosine omega t plus pi and this complex version using Euler's relation. Euler's relation is e to the I theta equals the cosine of theta plus I sine theta, where I is the square root of negative 1. So two versions of the Euler, one with a positive theta and the other one with a negative theta, you can add and subtract the two equations, and you can get cosine, for example, as the sum of the two cases of this exponential divided by 2. The sine is actually the difference divided by 2i. So you can use this to transform one of the solutions a while ago, this A cosine omega t plus pi, and express this in terms of the exponentials using this equivalence. And then segregate the sums, the addends. And because pi and A are still arbitrary constants, you can call this combination of A and e to the I pi as C1, and similarly A and e to the minus I pi as C2. And that's exactly the fourth form, is equation 7. And so these two are equivalent. In fact, all of these are equivalent if you just take the time to verify using the Euler relation. So that's the setup. We have a solution to this differential equation. Now, in physics or in many other fields, there are initial conditions. This evolution in time of the displacement begins somewhere in time. So there is an initial value for the position, time zero, and initial velocity at time zero. If those are provided to you in units of length and length per time, for meter and meter per second, then you can use them, you can impose them on the mathematical solution to find the constants A1 and A2. And this is, for example, if you set time t equals zero in the general solution, the cosine of zero is 1, the sine of zero is 0. So you're left with an equation that says A1 equals x0. And x0 is given, so you can update the solution with the A1 replacement, x0. The velocity is the derivative of this function. Okay? The derivative of cosine is negative sine. The derivative sine is cosine, and there's a chain rule that will liberate an omega from the composite function. So there is the derivative. If the initial condition says initially at time zero, you have V0 as the initial velocity, then encode it into this differential, this function with t equals zero, and it will tell you what A2 is equal to. So you can now update with the now calculated A1 and A2, this is now the solution, and this is consistent with the boundary conditions or the initial conditions. And from that, you can also calculate the other things like the velocity and the acceleration. So the energy is easily shown using this X and V. Okay, it's a kinetic plus potential energy. If you substitute this X and this V into that formula for the total mechanical energy, you will find that it will simplify to its initial value of time t equals zero. In other words, the energy is the same at any time. It is the same as what it was at time t equals zero. So it is a conservative system. And now, when there is drag, then the oscillator will slow down, of course, because there is a velocity dependent force that is against the movement. So there is this minus C B to the N. The N is a number that is empirically determined depending on what fluid, how viscous the fluid you are in. So that's called the drag coefficient and the power for the drag coefficient, the drag of the drag force. So for instance, in this diagram, the y-axis is upwards. So when the displacement is positive from the equilibrium, the displacement is positive. Gravity, of course, is always pointing downwards, negative mg. The velocity is upwards in this case. It's still on the way up. Okay? And so what you will see there is that the drag is against the velocity. The drag is against the velocity, negative CB. In this case, I'm just using the linear drag case. And the spring is it's a force that is against the displacement. So negative KY is also downwards. So if you now rewrite this, divide both sides by M, you will see that you have this differential equation. It's almost like the oscillator, but now there is a beta and a certain power of the velocity, dy dt. And of course, the uniform gravity is also an additional constant. If you remove G and the beta, then this becomes the conservative oscillator. But this one, because of the dependence on velocity, it's no longer conservative. So that's the damped oscillator. This is the case when there is only N equals 1, the linear damping. Now you can hide the G by this substitution. So it becomes simpler to look at. And the solution to that is easily verified as this sum of two exponentials with two constants to be determined by initial conditions. And that's easily proven. I'll just flash the proof here. Just substitute the proposed solution S, differentiate it, and differentiate it again, and then simplify this, you will get an identity. So that's the proof. So we have the exact solution. And when you reappear the G from the differential, because a while ago we hid it using the substitution, now you can encode it again, solve for y of t, then this G will be subtracted from the system. And you have this constant, which shifts the equilibrium to negative G over omega naught squared. But nevertheless, it's still the same oscillation. That radicand determines whether it will be overdamped, it will oscillate, or underdamped. You can differentiate that and get velocity and acceleration. So this is the complete solution to the damped oscillator. Now, let's look at this interesting differential equation, second order, but as you can see, there are singularities here at x equals 0. It's a singularity that can be removed. No? It's a non-essential singularity because the power is just second order in the denominator most. So this is a non-essential singularity. And Frobenius method is valid in this case. It is it promises to provide at least one solution because there is no essential singularity. But when alpha is zero, the equation becomes simple harmonic. But then, in fact, there is this term with an 1 over x squared, it disappears when alpha equals zero. There is another case where it also disappears when alpha is negative 1. Okay? And when alpha is equal to negative 1, it becomes the damped oscillator. So the cases are, the special cases are connected to the classical oscillator. So, but how do you solve that? Well, you can try Frobenius, and you can also try my proposed solution here. this is the point transformation that will reveal the secret of this differential equation. So look at that. It's y equals x to the power alpha times u. You can differentiate it once, differentiate it twice, and then substitute it there and find an equation that is familiar. That's the oscillator equation. So this transformation reveals that this equation is connected to the classical oscillator. And because we know the solution to the classical oscillator, this is finished. This is finished. We can now write down immediately the solution. The only difference is that there's an x to the alpha. And alpha is just any number. You can try x equals 0 and you will recover the oscillator. Or x equals negative 1. Okay. That will be something else. And in fact, you can try any alpha of your fancy and you will see an exact solution to the differential equation. The form of this alpha equals negative 1 case is something that has a name. It's the Emden-Euler differential equation. So that's the solution that we have derived when alpha is equal to negative 1. If you will look at sine omega x over x, that is reminiscent of the interference pattern when you have waves interfering. So, and in fact, even in quantum mechanics, the absolute square of that becomes the something important in the localization of wave packets. So this equation is quite important in physics. Now, you can try the Frobenius method. I will not linger on this because this is a standard procedure in ArfCAN, but I'll just flash the solution right here. You can substitute a series, okay, this form with an unknown k, and also the coefficients are unknown. Differentiate it 2 times, substitute these assumptions into the differential equation. This is the Emden-Euler case, okay? So, and then simplify the resulting equation. You can find the initial value of the coefficient of the lowest power of this series, and that will provide the value of k in this solution. Okay. There are 2 k's that we find here. It's k equals 0 and k equals negative 1. And then, so there will be 2 solutions that can be extracted from this method. The recurrence relation is also found from this master equation that came from the differential equation. And it's just a matter of setting to 0 the coefficient of the same powers of x. So you'll have to shift the n by 2, because this one is x to the k plus n plus 1, while this is k plus n minus 1. So to get the same powers, you have to shift n to n plus 2. And from there, you can find the recurrence relation. Or k equals negative 1, you can find the series coefficients, and you'll find cosine omega x over x, as expected. If you do it again for k equals 0, the other value of the initial equation, then you will find sine omega x over omega x. And the linear combination of those 2 agrees with our solution. So that's the series approach. Now, in the study of black holes, because recently there has been observations of interesting black holes, the M87 and the black hole at the center of our galaxy, the people who study this are very excited about connecting dark matter and these black holes, how dark matter modifies the shadow, the dark region of the black hole, supposed to be a region where light cannot escape from. So it is called a shadow. Now, how does dark matter, the other mysterious thing in this universe that we don't understand, affect the size of the shadow and the shape of the shadow? So they analyzed this and they form the metric of space-time here according to Einstein's theory of relativity. And as you will notice here, there is this Schwarzschild radius where, you know, there's an event horizon at r equals 2gm over c squared. There is an effect of charge. If the black hole is charged, there's a q squared over r squared. And if the universe is accelerating in its expansion, there is also a cosmological expansion term here, which is an r squared. And finally, people added the dark fluid, this 1 over r log of r, with a lambda measuring, quantifying the amount of dark fluid surrounding, okay, it's the halo surrounding the black. And so that expression there, 1 over r ln of r, that's an interesting object because it has a local maximum at 2.718, Euler's or Napier's constant. And it also has an inflection point as it decreases as you move away from the black hole. So those things are motivations for analyzing differential equations with logarithms or logarithmic singularities like these differential equation. They look really discouraging because of the logarithms there. Frobenius would not dare to approach this, I think, because Frobenius is for polynomial singularities. And if there's a logarithm, that's something that is not so easily addressed. So what is this differential equation? Well, I claim that this differential equation has an exact solution, and I can show you what it is. Okay, you don't have to suffer the series approach. Let's see. So there it is. That's the differential equation. It has these logarithms here in the denominator. And if you analyze that, that when alpha approaches zero, it becomes indeterminate. So you use the L'Hopital's rule, and you find that it is just 1 over ln x. So the alpha actually can cancel because you see x to the alpha in a logarithm, alpha can come in front. Okay? Can come in front according to logarithm's laws, and it will cancel the alpha. So this limit actually is what is more relevant. But there are singularities, no? So there is this red asymptote, and also at the origin, x equals zero and x equals one. So it segregates the real axis into manageable fragments for solution. But how do you solve it? Well, here is the secret. If you substitute u equals y over ln x alpha, things miraculously settle down. Yes, you have to differentiate that. You have to know how to differentiate things with logarithms in the denominator, second derivative, and then substitute them there, and there. And lo and behold, after a few strokes, this actually settles and cancels many things, and it becomes the damped oscillator equation, which we know the solution of. Therefore, we can write down the solution of this strange-looking logarithmic singularity differential equation, but we have an exact solution in this form. This form. So this is an exact solution that you might want to try deriving using other methods. That's one major part of my report, showing you that there is a point transformation that exactly solves this differential equation. I have never seen this differential equation before until I became interested in the black hole shadows and the effect of dark fluid black hole. So hopefully I will find more differential equations of that sort, and also find a hidden transformation that will give me the exact solution. Okay, so that's one success. Now let's try another one. This one is another differential equation. This time the logarithms are above, not in the denominator. And it also has that Schwarzschild singularity, 1 over r, 1 over x. And this time, this is the interesting power in the denominator, x to the x. If you're studying calculus and somebody asks you, what is the limit of x to the power x as x goes to zero? In other words, you will get zero to the power zero. What is the limit? What is zero to the power zero? And of course, you will ask help from L'Hopital's and other methods. But the best thing to do is, I think, to graph it. Okay. But anyway, if you make this transformation for this differential equation, lo and behold, you find after a few pages of simplification, you will find again the damped oscillator. So you can write down the exact solution. And here is the exact solution. Let me just open very quickly. A picture that will show you these curious things. There, that's a maybe an idea. So here. So that green curve is x to the x. Don't mind the other hierarchies there, x to the x to the x. Let's just focus on the x to the x, the green curve. Follow it down and closer to the origin, and you'll see it actually settles to 1. 0 to the 0 is 1. Okay. On the other hand, if you have these other creatures here, they might, the yellow one goes to 1, but the white one goes to 0. So you really have to follow these things. And if this is involved in your logarithm or in your differential equation, then what I've shown you is that there might be a transformation, a point transformation, a power point transformation, this is our powers, that can reduce it to an exactly solvable differential equation. So that's all I have to report. I hope you have acquired something from my little calculations. Thank you, everyone. Good day.